Well, hi, I'm Stephen Holt. Yes, I am. I'm still Stephen Holt. And guess what? I'm still at the Toronto Festival 2009, even though it feels like 2010. But hey, you know, Christmas and New Year's are right around the corner, but it feels like spring up here in Toronto. Look, the flowers are out already, and I feel younger than springtime today, I have to say, because you're going to see one of the great interviews of my career today with Peter Schneider. Now, who is Peter Schneider? Well, he's the former, he was either the CEO, the chairman, the head of animation, or all of those things of Disney. You know Walt Disney, don't you? He made us all the way we are today. I grew up on Disney. Every single, first movie I ever saw was Peter Pan. Obviously, a heavy influence. And he has this wonderful movie up here called Waking Sleeping Beauty. It's a doc. It's on the years of amazing and cataclysmic change at Disney, where they produced all of their great work, where they changed the animation landscape. I mean, Beauty and the Beast getting nominated for a Best Picture for an animated film. Never happened before. And they lost to Silence of the Lambs, but you know all that already, because you know all this stuff. You're Oscar-ologist, just like myself. So anyway, Peter's going to tell us all about that, and he's also going to tell us about his and my backstory. Yes, we've known each other a very long time, before you all were even born, practically. And I was 2 and he was 3. But anyway, we're old friends reuniting on camera here today at the Toronto Film Festival on the Stephen Holt Show. Wow!
We've known each other. You're recording? You're not recording, are you?
I am recording.
We've known each other since 1972.
Well,
72. That would be, count them, 37 years.
Oh my God!
We are started, and
you were 2 and I was 3, and you know, we were in kindergarten, and it was just fabulous, you know. Peter, I haven't seen you.
I know.
Since then, basically.
No, I saw you a couple times.
But your personality has changed, young man.
It has.
Listen, you were so shy and so quiet and so monosyllabic
and so naive.
Were you?
Remember Hugh Giddens?
Yes. A wonderful black flamboyant director who I get was one of the first extreme queens I've ever met in my life, and now
it was the first extreme queen that I'd ever met in my life.
So you met him before me.
Are you gay?
Yeah, well, yeah, over the years. I know Helen Hanf got you very confused.
Yeah,
I know.
Right.
We got married eventually.
Oh,
God. Anyway, that other. Anyway, I'm gay now, for sure. But you're married, you have 2 kids?
2
and
kids.
And they've grown up, probably?
Yeah, 21 and 24.
Oh, my God. What are their names? We'll see.
Rebecca and Hannah, and they're the love of my life, along with my wife, Hope.
Hope, I met Hope.
You met
she
Hope?
Was one. It, yes, you introduced us.
Yes, I did.
She hugged me, and it was a beautiful moment all
right.
the way around.
But you've done so well. I mentioned your name to my director, Don Hahn, and he went, oh, he's that wacky guy on Late Night.
Oh, well, yes, that's true. I can't deny it. And, but, I mean, it's nothing compared to what, the biggest thing about you is the surprise, because you were so shy, and so you would be careful about your sentences, you wouldn't talk much.
I didn't drink at that time.
Oh, never. No,
never.
You were Coca-Cola, totally sober. And
look what's happened.
What were you doing directing Reedy in Hell, my 3rd musical, which
was...
You know,
I wish I would do it today.
Well, it's the script's available.
I'm just saying, I just don't know if I was equipped to do justice.
Well, you were, I mean, in the sense, except it was set, okay, Hell was a musical comedy that you could never stop rehearsing, and it was supposed to be set in a Westinghouse oven, symbolic of the oppression of women, but we had no ovens. It was just black set. With a red pipe, I think it was a red pipe.
And red lights.
And red lights,
and
yes.
And Robin O'Hara.
Who's
our lead.
Who's your friend.
Who's my friend, who also has a movie here at Toronto.
Called?
The Good Heart.
Which I didn't see. Did you see it?
I saw it. It's lovely.
Okay.
It was beautiful. It was lovely. It was emotional. Brian Cox's performance is superb.
Oh, that's what he was doing here. Okay.
Yes, yes. Superb performance.
Yes. Well, we could segue right into Peter's superb documentary called Waking Sleeping Beauty, which is what we're doing here. But I mean, I imagine my shock last night to see this person, like I didn't barely recognize except physically, because you were shy, you were circumspect. I thought, what in the world is this person doing directing my play? But on the other hand, there you were, and here we are, and it's looking
beautiful.
Did you
like the movie?
It was wonderful. I loved it. It's a great doc here at the Toronto International Film Festival. It's called Waking Sleeping Beauty. And I thought it was going to be a biopic about you, but it's not.
No.
No. It's about the history of the incredible, fantastic thing that happened to animation in a certain, what years do you are covering?
84 to 94. Little Mermaid, Roger Rabbit, Beauty and the Beast, Lion King,
Aladdin.
And
we started hashing stuff out and throwing around ideas. Initially, it was very, very collegial. It was very upbeat. We were having a lot of fun. But one of the things that was a sticking point, something that we didn't agree on, was how to open the movie. And Howard felt very passionately that the movie should open with a fully animated prologue that showed the Beast in his prince form, except he would be a little boy. He'd be a naughty little boy. To Howard, it seemed incredibly moving and tragic.
He was also very opinionated and very articulate and very intimidating. And so we were scared of him. It's like, okay, we got to do this.
And so, you know, like the stupid, naive 26-year-old kid that I was, I opened the meeting with, "We think that the little Beast Boy is kind of a cheap shot." And I think the word cheap really set Howard off.
His mouth was like a very tight line, and his eyes were getting like kind of bigger. And
I just saw the clouds darken. I just saw his face darken, and he just ripped into us like I've never been ripped into before. And no one leapt to my defense, may I just add. Thank you very much.
I mean, again, about creativity and about the chaos of creativity.
And the back room, back story of what goes on at Disney. I mean, like, I don't think I've ever met anybody who's corporate at all. I mean, but seeing this movie, I thought, well, I guess that's why I'm not involved with that end of the business. It was just, it's a must-see for anybody who wants to go into show business, because if you can get through what happens in this movie, and you still want to be in it, It's tough stuff. It's tough stuff. If kids don't know, if they're naive, they won't be naive after they see it.
Well, out of great chaos comes great art. You have to have chaos.
But you sense that about me, I think, initially.
You are chaotic.
I know, still. I know to this day.
I know.
And anyway, so Reedy in Hell was a musical that was set in hell. And next thing I knew, I mean, fast forward, he's the head of animation at Disney. I was like, what the? And I thought, how is you ever going to? And at the time, you knew nothing about animation,
nothing
I have to say.
Animation.
And there you were, the president of the Cartoon Kingdom.
But it's, you know, what I love about Disney, what I love about Disney animation, it's about artists. It's about artists creating. It's about empowering people to do the best they can.
When I got animation, I knew I had 100 days to change the culture before it changed me. I was trying to empower people, to make them feel good about themselves, to value the work.
Peter picked apart every piece of the production process. Why are we punching time clocks? Why are we making our own paint? Why can't we update our animation pigs? Why don't we have more computers? What are we doing about training? It had this feeling of a freight train leaving the station at light speed. You better jump on or jump off fast. Most people got on, and it was a wild ride, an exciting time. There was this team sport mentality. You can't play the game unless everybody's firing off on all cylinders. Even if you're second string, you were hungry to be part of this, to jump into the game. There was an openness, a permission almost, to be critical about anything.